It's a huge country. It's sparsely populated. 35 million people, 7,000 kilometers across, six time zones. There's many French farmers, French customers outside of Quebec. Also in Atlantic Canada, there's a fairly high French population. And also through Ontario, Eastern Ontario mainly, there's a lot of French farmers, French customers. So we basically took the opinion that we do everything in both languages. When you look at field sizes, so Eastern Canada, much more common with a country like France, for example, in terms of field sizes. So, you know, the field sizes are generally smaller than Western Canada. Western Canada, they work by sections. So I think a quarter section is a quarter square mile or something. So the surface you're working is huge, you know, whereas the tractor you might drive for an hour or 2 hours before you even turn around, you know. So the working sections, and actually they refer to it in the West as a section of land, they're much bigger than Eastern Canada, because one, there's no, you don't have the same drainage ditches that you need in Eastern Canada. You don't have those out West. So the biggest challenge in terms of farm machinery is distribution and getting your product to your customers. So of course our farm dealerships, our agriculture equipment dealerships, they're not in the densely populated areas. They're out in the countryside close to their customers. So the big challenge is getting those products to the customers. That's a huge challenge, and it's very costly, right? So shipping stuff by truck or shipping stuff by train or whatever is still the preferred methods of transporting your goods across Canada. Most of our products that we sell in Canada, a lot of them get lumped into the US, you know, export, where a lot of our products might go to the US before they're exported. So our agriculture is undeniably linked to US agriculture. Now, whether it's meat processing, whether it's corn, soybeans. I mean, we do export, of course. We export a lot to other countries directly. But that's not to say that some of it doesn't get sent and mixed in with a type of a U.S. product. So I think there is an influence from the U.S., and that might be seed varieties. That might be, you know, chemicals we spray. Herbicides, insecticides, you know, U.S., kind of U.S. defined. In terms of soil agronomy, and in terms of soil structure and analysis for your types of soil and stuff, I do think that Europe has more of an influence, because they're, Europe, correct me if I'm wrong, Antoine, on this, but I think Europe is becoming less reliant on spray the hell out of it. And more focused on, you know, traditional cultivation methods, whereas the USA is a little still focused on. So of the 65 million hectares that's being cultivated in Canada, there's 60% of that is no-till seeding or zero-till seeding. Yeah, so it's basically no-till. 60% of everything that's planted, direct seeding. And that comes from the fact that Saskatchewan, parts of Alberta and Manitoba has the largest land mass for its arable soil. So that comes from that. 24% of that land mass is tillage, retaining most crop residue on the surface area. So some sort of minimum till, like you go over a corn with lemkin and you leave residue. And of course, and then there's 17% that tillage incorporating most crop residue in the soil acre. So if you're going over with something that's incorporating more and more of your no-till. So it's clear that 60% is all no-till, right? So clear. This is not a new trend, right? This has been happening in the past 20 years, this move towards no-till. However, you got to look at the details, and the details are saying the provinces of Saskatchewan, parts of Alberta and Manitoba, that's zero-till because it's dry land farming. If you cultivate the ground in a normal year, most of your topsoil will be blown away in the wintertime, you know, with heavy winds, like winter weather. If there's no snow covering the ground, the topsoil is gone, right? So those large surfaces have to keep some sort of residue on the ground with a cover crop or something to prevent that erosion of soil in the wintertime. You know, there's one thing about agriculture in Canada, agriculture in a winter climate, that many people don't take into consideration when they're talking about it. And if we look, for example, at the dairy sector, you know, when farms have these huge number of milking cows, well, one, you know, past October until, you know, end of May, beginning of June, you need to house, you know, enough forage and feed to feed your head through those, you know, six, eight months of the year. So you need to have the stock. You need to accumulate enough forage to feed your animals through that period of winter. Very important. And you also need to house those animals in a kind of weather permitting building. So they're not, it's not an outdoor environment. That's correct. In winter, this, I mean, you're not doing anything in the winter, no matter where you are in Canada, you're not doing anything. And just to mention, like, the extremes across Canada. So in wintertime, in some parts of Canada, you'll see minus 35 degrees Celsius in the winter. Mainly could be, you know, January, a little bit into February, you'll see minus 30, minus 35. And in summertime, you'll see plus 35. So you have an extreme variance in temperature from minus 35 to plus 35. So, but of course, in terms of agriculture, yeah, nobody's working past, actually right now, December, as we go into December, it's I think everybody is pretty much finished working now. You can get away with doing some tillage in December if the frost is not deep into the ground or there's not a lot of snow. But nobody's really touching the ground until March.